All right, so it is April 8, 2015, and of course we're still in the Feast of Unleavened Bread, and we're going to be continuing still in Isaiah chapter 40 and onward. But first, let's thank our Heavenly Family and ask them for guidance. Heavenly Family, thank you so much for this feast. We've been enjoying unleavened bread in more than one way. And we just want to ask for an increase of comprehension. Heavenly Family, it is incredible to be here at this time and to know that you are speaking with us and that you're speaking comfortably at that. And that you have a message of good news, and that you simply want us to incline our ears and to listen and hear what you have to say and enter into an everlasting covenant with you. So, Heavenly Family, even though the world is in a terrible condition and the church is as well, and as branches, we've been in a worse condition than any others. And perhaps that's why you're able to show us your mercy more clearly. And for that, we thank you. So, Heavenly Family, please help us to focus and to think clearly and to gain a better understanding of these passages of Scripture than we ever have before. Not just simply for knowing what they say or having a theory of the truth, but so that we can obey what we find there, and that our lives can be truly changed by the molding and forming of your word, and that we can be a witness to the world, and that your prayer, dear brother, can finally come to its perfect fulfillment, that we may be one that the world might believe, all for the sake of your love and for your kingdom. Thank you so much, Heavenly Family and Father, Mother. As you know, we ask these things in the name of your children, Branch, he and she. Amen.
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 Okay. So, last night we got up to the end of verse 11. And, yeah, today I'll mention a few things and then we'll kind of see if anyone else has anything to share from what they've studied as well. And in fact, why don't we just do that first? Let's just see, you know, if any of you have happened to look more at any of these passages, whether, again, it's Isaiah chapter 40 to 52 and even on beyond that, or Ezekiel 1 to 11, or the passages in the Psalms, again, Psalm 8, Psalm 74, Psalm 89, Psalm 104, and any other connected passages from there. If anyone has anything from those passages that they've studied and it guided them somewhere, or if there's other passages that you've happened to study that you see a connection between these passages and whatever other passage it may be, then totally feel free to mention it now. So, just wanted to give this time in case anyone has anything.
I read Psalms 99 for my third-hour devotion, and I was amazed at how it talked about glory being revealed, and it kind of really stirred me up, and I started looking at all the other ones. You know, I can't remember exactly what it said, but it was so similar that it got me kind of stirred up for my morning devotion.
Beautiful. Yeah, see, okay, that's 99, right?
99, right.
Yes, okay, there we go. Yeah, that's one. I'm glad that you mentioned that. Everyone add it to your list to study it along with it. Yahweh reigns, the nations tremble. He sits enthroned above the winged angels, or in Hebrew, it's actually above the cherubim. And the earth shakes. The Lord is elevated in Zion. He is exalted over all the nations, etc., etc. I won't read the whole thing right now. But right from the beginning, yeah, it's talking about the Shekinah. And verse 7 talks about speaking from the pillar of cloud and so on, all about the Shekinah. Exodus typology, talking about Moses and Aaron. Interesting how it says Moses and Aaron were among his priests. So it even considers Moses a priest there. Talks about Samuel.
I changed everything to all the he's to she's. That's the person that's going to be revealed. You know, the glory of God, exalt the Lord our God. It's the God that's leading us on earth while our brother's in heaven mediating for us. So that's what all these other things we're talking about, that God's glorified by. Go ahead.
Yeah, I was just wanting to add something to what you said there. It says worship before his footstool in verse 5, and we know that the earth is his footstool. So just wanted to add that to what you're saying about the one who is on earth. But didn't mean to interrupt. You can continue on. Please do.
It says, exalt the Lord our God. That's the God, the unknown God. Nobody knows. But she's going to be exalted in nobody knows that she's the one that's been taking care of him for a long time.
Right. Yeah, no, and there are definitely places where in Hebrew it actually says she, and it's translated as he, or where some manuscripts say she and others say he and all that. We'll talk about some of that tonight. And then there's other places where it says he, but the persons being referred to is actually a group of more than one person, which is a combination of male and female. And so the singular masculine is often used as a collective, and it's just not gender specific. That's the sort of thing that we went through in that divine plurality, in those divine plurality articles. And but, of course, there are other places where it actually just says he, and it's referring to a male. So we have to consider each particular case on its own merits and see what it says.
Right.
And
but even though maybe the rest of her family is included there, but she's in that group and nobody knows her or her mother are even in the group. So
it's true.
They know the father and the son, but they don't know the mother and the daughter. So when it says exalt the Lord our God, it's saying exalt the feminine side of the Godhead too, and worship at her holy hill.
Praise our heavenly family.
For the Lord our God is holy.
Amen. Amen. I'm really glad that you mentioned that, Leroy. So if especially for those of you who are going to be looking through the Psalms or who have been looking through the Psalms, consider this passage as well. Because definitely talking about the being enthroned above the cherubim and so on and so forth, elevating Zion or being elevated in Zion and all of that, all has its relevance to this.
Isn't she the main one that's inhabiting with us here on earth? The Father and the Mother and Jesus are all mainly doing their work in heaven.
Amen. That's exactly the case. If you read Zechariah 2, it shows Yahweh who sends another Yahweh, and the Yahweh who is sent is the glory in the midst of Jerusalem, and she goes to dwell in Zion and so on. It's definitely her. Definitely the Shekinah.
Would you repeat the reference where the passage is located again?
The one that Leroy's referencing or the one that I just referenced in Zechariah?
Leroy.
Psalm 99. So, yeah, did anyone else have any other passages or anything else that came to mind as they're studying? Or if someone just wanted to share a line that they were studying in relation to all this?
Well, I did. As I was reading back through Isaiah 40, I noticed, you know, in verse 18, it says, to whom then will you liken God, or what likeness will you compare unto him? And, you know, it's just such a theme throughout the Psalms, and now I see it everywhere, you know, that our Heavenly Family points out these aspects of themselves and having to do with their ability to create and to change. And so I started thinking about this language. It brought to mind Job. And so, because, you know, that was the thing that that our Heavenly Family was saying to Job, you know, reminding him of the difference between him and them, you know. And like, so I started thinking about that, you know, I started thinking about the issue of us being without form and void, you know, in the verse of Genesis when she flutters over the waters. So I started thinking about that, and, you know, we are without form. We need to have a different form. So I started just thinking about that, you know, and okay, well, how do we get formed? Well, all these messages, like last night in particular, you know, it all has to do with we need to be informed of something. And so they inform us, and that information reforms us, and it gives us a different form, you know, in the sense that we become like them in our minds, you know. Mm-hmm. And so I was just thinking about that, and then I thought, this is so elementary. It's so ridiculously elementary. It's like, oh, yeah, okay, this whole religion thing is all just about the truth. And everything that stands in the way of us thinking the truth, we need to get rid of it, you know, because it's an idol. And everything that, you know, every message our sister brings to us, our Heavenly Family brings, you know, all has to do with information that we need to, you know, so that we can live forever, so we can become like them in that sense. And then, like last night, it's so beautiful. Okay, here's this information. Now here's what to do with it, because we've got to get it to others. You know, we've got to share it. And I don't know, it just, like I said, it's just so elementary, but it's so deep to me, because it's like I'm finally, you know, getting that, and that, you know, and this week is really good in that it kind of gets us in that mode of, you know, we should be doing this all the time, you know, we should be studying all the time and spending huge amounts of time. I mean, really, for our Heavenly Family to be our God, that's really a much different thing than I have ever known, because it doesn't leave any room for anything to be as important. And so I was looking at, in the Study Bible, you know, there are comments by Ellen White. So in the section on Isaiah 40, she says, she says a whole bunch of stuff, but right here I thought this was good. Anything that is made the subject of undue thought and admiration, and it's in the context she's talking about varieties of gods men worship, you know, because that's, you know, that is certainly talked about a lot in this. Anything that is made the subject of undue thought and admiration, absorbing the mind, is a god chosen before the Lord. God is a searcher of the heart. He distinguishes between the true heart service and idolatry. So nothing, you know, really profound, except that to me it seems really profound, because, you know, it's a heart thing, I guess.
Yeah, I would say it's profound for sure. I mean, it's in one sense, like you said, it seems very simple, but at the same time, and so elementary, but that those are the points that people fail on. You know, those are the points that people need to have really settled. And if those things are really settled, let's just say someone really settles on the thing that they will not value anything above what it should be valued, and that they will really have our Heavenly Family as their true gods. I mean, that right there is justification by faith. That's it, casting away the idols. And yeah, it is fundamental and elementary and all that, but that's exactly what our Heavenly Family is trying to tell us about. So it's absolutely profound. Yeah, and you know, this passage in Isaiah, there is a whole lot. And I'm sure as we go on to the other chapters and everything too, we'll see, again, there is a whole lot in all of this.
Can I say one more thing really fast?
Yeah, sure.
Okay. Well, and it made me think of Haggai, you know, that we were reading so recently, you know, and especially when we were reading the part that was our instruction as to what we're supposed to do with Judah, you know, I just kept thinking of Haggai, you know, saying, go get wood, you know, build the temple.
Mm-hmm, totally.
I'm not sure if I'm quoting that right. But.
Yeah, well, it's the same, it's the basic message that's there for sure. Yeah, when you said it, it just reminded me of another passage here later in Isaiah 40. Mm-hmm. So that's quite interesting. We'll get to that more too, I guess. Was there anything else that anyone had to share? And by the way, I'm really enjoying this. I think that our meetings should consist more and more of this sort of thing. People studying and, okay, yeah, these are the pieces that I found. This is it. And it will, without a doubt, help us to understand the whole better.
I had some things that I was looking at today. I was primarily focused on Isaiah 40 and 41, although it kind of took me to a couple other places as well. But in Isaiah 40, verse 31, where it says, but they that wait upon Yahweh shall renew their strength. They shall mount up with wings as eagles. And then it goes on, they shall run and not be weary, and they shall walk and not faint. Well, I'm sure there's a lot more there than what I'm going to mention, but I was just noticing how it says that they shall mount up with wings as eagles. And we know that wings represent truth. And so I was just noticing how that is what's going to raise us up, the truth. And like I said, I'm sure there's a lot more there.
Just one other quick note on that. If people want to read more on that, Lois Roden wrote this study as an eagle, where she goes through that and she talks about how in this passage, as well as others, God's people are likened unto baby eagles with their mother eagle, the Holy Spirit. And that's all gone into more in the as an eagle study.
You know, along that line, I was going to mention that too, because I've been listening to that study. But, you know, that's taken from Deuteronomy 32:11-12. As an eagle stirreth up her nest, fluttereth over her young, spreadeth abroad her wings, taketh them, beareth them on her wings. So the Lord alone did lead them, and there was no strange God with him. Okay, and, you know, and that's this language of fluttering over the waters, you know. But, you know, I guess I had forgotten, but no strange God with him. And then in verse 13, he made him ride on the high places. You know who him is?
Yes, who runs?
Jacob, yeah.
Yeah.
Amen. Lots of connections.
Yeah.
And actually, that the reason why I said Yeshurun as well is because Deuteronomy 32 is the first place where Jacob is given the name Yeshurun, and that's the name spoken of in Isaiah 44 that's given to Jacob, and it's paralleled with Israel. Yeshurun, Israel, it's this new prophetic name, and it is that's the one that is kind of covertly hinted toward in, I think it was verse 3 of Isaiah 4, when it talks about the crooked must be made straight. The word straight there is Yeshur or Yeshar, and it's the same, it's the root that Yeshurun is based off of. So, yeah, that's kind of interesting. Deuteronomy 32 in connection with all this as well. Awesome.
The connections grow. So, yeah, that was one thing that I noticed in my study today. A couple other things that stood out, also from Isaiah 40, verse 31, and Isaiah 41, verse 1, where it says, it has the phrase, renew their strength. That kind of was standing out to me as well. And so I just read Isaiah 40, 31. So Isaiah 41, verse 1 says, which is just the very next verse, you know, 31 is the end of Isaiah 40. And then it goes to Isaiah 41. Keep silence before me, O islands, and let the people renew their strength. Let them come near, then let them speak. Let us come near together to judgment. And in the NET, it reads like this. Listen to me in silence, you coastlands. Let the nations find renewed strength. Let them approach and then speak. Let us come together for debate. So as I was kind of comparing those, and I'm looking at this, I hadn't gone to Hotep's writings yet on the topic, but I was considering this passage, and I thought, let the nations find renewed strength. So, you know, God is speaking there. He says, listen to me in silence, you coastlands. In other words, you know, be quiet and listen. And you coastlands or you islands. Now, I have kind of an idea just from what we've been studying and kind of the context of what I think it is. I think it's related to the wicked gods, but I haven't talked to Trent about this, haven't discussed it with him. I don't know if that's right or not. But let the nations find renewed strength. And I was like, renewed strength. So here's what I wrote just as I was contemplating the meaning. I said, this sounds like Yahweh telling the wicked gods that they have to allow the nations to find renewed strength, that the nations need a fair chance to choose the truth or to be changed by the truth, that the nations should be allowed to approach Yahweh and speak to them, and that there will be a judgment that takes place. So then I went to, I forget which TG it is, but where Hotep deals with Isaiah 40 and 41. And here's what he has to say on that passage. To renew their strength is to put away sin, and to come near to God is to learn of him. Having done this, they are then to invite others to come to judgment. The nations will keep silence until that time, and then will they say, come and let us go up to the mountain of the Lord and to the house of the God of Jacob, and he will teach us of his ways, and we will walk in his paths. For the law shall go forth of Zion, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem, Micah 4:2. Then Hotep says, our work is therefore to prepare the way of the Lord for the gathering of the people. And in that statement, Hotep basically says that it's the nations that will keep silence. And so, I don't know, can you expand on that, or shall we wait till we, for another day till we actually get to that in the progression?
I think people should do the experiment.
Okay.
And just go and see what does that scripture mean, and how do you know? You know, we've talked about context, we've talked about how to study and so on before. So if we want to know what the coastlands are, well, let's look up every time Isaiah talks about coastlands. Let's see the context. What are the, you know, does he ever talk about coastlands within the same context? Does he explain what that is? And if he doesn't, are there other writings in Scripture that do? You know, so it's good for people to search that out and see what it says.
Okay, well, that'll be my next step on this section here. And then, I don't know, I have more. Do you want me to share more? Or,
sure.
Yeah? Okay. So another passage that stood out to me is at Isaiah 41, verse 10. And it says, "Fear thou not, for I am with thee. Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. Yea, I will help thee. Yea, I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness." And, of course, there's a lot of encouragement in there. Now, one of the things Hadith has to say about that is, hey, we wouldn't have to be told to fear not if we weren't afraid. And we shouldn't be afraid. "Fear thou not, for I am with thee." Yahweh is with us. "Be not dismayed, for I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. Yea, I will help thee." And then it says, "I will uphold thee with the right hand of my righteousness." And so a hand, I was thinking, okay, well, you know, what does that mean? A hand represents the message of the prophet. And the right hand of my righteousness, so I was thinking that's the message of justification by faith.
Did you say a hand is a prophet?
No, I said the hand is the message of the prophet.
Okay. Just wanted to make sure.
It's the writings. It's the message, right? Or no?
The right hand, a hand just represents a message. Yeah. Not necessarily writings, but the writings are a means of conveying a message.
Right.
So, of course, they would be included.
So I was like, okay, the right hand being the strong hand, the strong message of my righteousness, the message of justification by faith. Okay, so then verses 11 and 12 say, "Behold, all they that were incensed against thee shall be ashamed and confounded. They shall be as nothing, and they that strive with thee shall perish. Thou shalt seek them and shall not find them. Even them that contended with thee, they that war against thee, shall be as nothing and as a thing of naught." So, yeah, there's the encouragement that, okay, well, these whoever's against us, who's ever warring against us, well, they're just going to be as nothing, and they're not going to be able to even be found. You know, they're not going to be able to overcome us. However, listen to what Victor Hadith had to say on this verse, on these two verses. "Now is our opportunity to do all we can for those who oppose us. For here we are plainly told that if they continue in their hostility, they shall perish." And isn't that the attitude that we should have? Not necessarily, oh, good, they're not going to be able to be against us forever. It's, hey, there's going to be a time when they're going to have to face judgment. Let's work for them now while they still have an opportunity to be saved. And then verses 14 and 15 says, "Fear not, thou worm Jacob, and ye men of Israel. I will help thee, saith Yahweh, and thy Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. Behold, I will make thee a new sharp threshing instrument having teeth. Thou shalt thresh the mountains and beat them small, and shalt make the hills as chaff." So it had been a while since I had really looked into the threshing instrument with sharp teeth symbolism. And, you know, I remembered some of the things that Doug had to say about it and all that, but I wanted to see, okay, how did the rod put this? And so here's what Victor Hadith had to say. "To thresh the mountains, or kingdoms, is to take the wheat, or saints, out of them. The servants of God, therefore, are here promised a new instrument, different from any ever used before. That is, the gathering of the saints in the harvest time is to be accomplished in a way undreamed of, contrary to every human planning. This instrument will have teeth. It will suddenly separate the wheat from the straw and blow out the chaff. Christ, whose fan is in his hand, will thoroughly purge his floor and gather his wheat into the garner, but he will burn up the chaff with unquenchable fire, Matthew 3:12. For this cause we are called, and for this great and grand work we are to prepare the way. So we are to be instruments, sharp threshing instruments. We are to speak the truth, the cutting truth, and to, you know, bring about this harvest. And but one of the other things that kind of stood out to me while I was reading all this is in Isaiah 40, verse 25, we see the phrase Holy One. And they have it capitalized. Holy and One are both capitalized. So I didn't get around to, like, you know, looking up, okay, what's the Hebrew word there and all this and that. But there's that, and then there's Isaiah 41, 14, 16, and 20. It also refers to the Holy One in capitals. And what I noticed is, like, for example, Isaiah 41, 14, it says, saith Yahweh, and thy Redeemer, the Holy One of Israel. And in 16, thou shalt rejoice in Yahweh, and shalt glory in the Holy One of Israel. And then again in verse 20, that the hand of Yahweh hath done this, and the Holy One of Israel hath created it. So I started asking the question, okay, you know, it sounds like those are two different persons. And the Holy One, so, you know, what I'm thinking now is that the Holy One is our sister, but we'll have to look more into that, because I don't know for sure.
Amen. That's what I was wanting to mention a little while ago. She says, I am thy God. I will strengthen thee. The Holy One of Israel, it's our sister.
Mm-hmm. That's what I'm thinking. I definitely want to, you know, be able to show more reason for that from the scriptures. But I won't be at all surprised to find that. And then look at Isaiah 41, 19 and 20. It reads like this, I will plant in the wilderness the cedar, the shittah tree, and the myrtle, and the oil tree. I will set in the desert the fir tree, and the pine, and the box tree together, that they may see, and know, and consider, and understand together, that the hand of Yahweh hath done this, and the Holy One of Israel hath created it. Now, when I read that, I don't know if anyone else has any bells ringing in their head of another passage in Scripture that, you know, makes it reminds him of, but it reminded me of a passage that when I searched it out turns out to be basically Isaiah chapter 61. And let's see, which verse was it now? For some reason, did I write that down for 7? No, those are two different connections, Isaiah 61, 7 and Isaiah 40, verse 2. But the planting of the Lord, the trees, the planting of the Lord.
That's in Isaiah 61.
Yeah, I know it's in Isaiah 61, but which verse? I'm missing it.
Are you talking about all the names of the trees?
I'm talking about where it says the trees of righteousness being the planting of the Lord.
Okay. Well, I just noticed in chapter 60, verse 13, it talks about the glory of Lebanon shall come unto thee, the fir tree, the pine tree, the box together, and be a place of sanctuary. That's probably not what you're thinking of.
Cool.
That's just more references to the different trees.
Oh, yeah, definitely. Definitely. And then we found the verse that I was looking for, too. It's Isaiah 61, verse 3. And if you read the whole thing in context, it's talking about this present message and messenger. And so I'm just going to read it in context because it's really, I think it's more meaningful in context. The Spirit of the Lord Yahweh is upon me, because Yahweh hath anointed me to preach good tidings unto the meek. He hath sent me to bind up the brokenhearted, to proclaim liberty to the captives, justification by faith, freedom from sin, and the opening of the prison to them that are bound, same thing, to proclaim the acceptable year of Yahweh and the day of vengeance of our God, to comfort all that mourn. And there's the comfort from verse 1 of Isaiah 40. To appoint unto them that mourn in Zion, and we were talking about Zion being the smaller portion of Jerusalem, to give unto them beauty for ashes, the oil of joy for mourning, the garment of praise for the spirit of heaviness. So it's this whole transformation picture of from death to life, that they might be called trees of righteousness, the planting of Yahweh, that he might be glorified. And so I was, you know, thinking of that in connection with Isaiah 41, 19, and 20. And then there was just a little bit more from my study today that was really standing out, and that was a comparison between Isaiah 40, verse 2, and Isaiah 61, verse 7. Isaiah 61, 7 says, for your, you know what, I'm gonna switch them. I'm going to read Isaiah 40, verse 2 first. Speak kindly to Jerusalem and tell her that her time of warfare is over, that her punishment is completed. For Yahweh has made her pay double for all her sins. And then Isaiah 61, 7 said, for your shame ye shall have double, and for confusion they shall rejoice in their portion. Therefore in their land they shall possess the double. Everlasting joy shall be unto them. And, you know, it seemed like, okay, well, the branch has done terribly, terribly bad, and has had to be punished double for all our sins. However, in the end, she'll also receive double. And praise the Lord for that. The only other thing tonight is in Isaiah 41, 22, 23, and 26, there's a lot of language, like in Genesis 1, 26 and 27, where it's the us and we. Let them bring forth and show us what shall happen. Let them show the former things what they be, that we may consider them, know the latter end of them, or declare us things for to come, etc., etc. And I was just thinking, okay, well, that warrants some further looking into. Is that another passage that shows multiple Yahwehs as well in the language of, you know, plurality, us and we, that was correctly translated into the King James? Interesting. So anyway, there's more still, but I'm going to pass it over to Trent now.
Well, we'll see. Does anyone else have anything else to share? I'm enjoying this so far, and I think there's good that comes out of it.
Well, I just have a quick comment. There was something from the Rod that Teresa was reading, I believe it was, in which you mentioned that the nations are going to have a chance, that, you know, that God is going to give the nations a chance to hear the message or something like that. Do you remember?
Yeah, it's, I forget the quote reference. It's, you know, it's one of the TGs, and the TG covers.
But that's kind of basically the idea, I believe.
Yeah, do you want me to read the quote again?
Yeah, sure. Be great.
Okay. To renew their strength is to put away sin, and to come near to God is to learn of him. Having done this, they are then to invite others to come to judgment. The nations will keep silence until that time, and then will they say, come and let us go up to the mountain of the Lord and to the house of the God of Jacob, and he will teach us of his ways, and we will walk in his paths. For the law shall go forth of Zion, and the word of the Lord from Jerusalem. And then Hatif says, our work is therefore to prepare the way of the Lord for the gathering of the people.
That's not exactly what I was remembering. something having to do with, or maybe it was. I don't know. Maybe I heard it wrong.
You're talking about the one where
maybe it was your. Yeah, Norman says maybe it was your comment. Anyway, I believe what I heard, what I'm thinking of, is that is the idea that the nations are going to be compelled, if you will. They're going to have to be fair, you know, so that people can, you know, to a certain extent, that there's going to have to be some leveling of the playing field. And I could be wrong about this, but what came to my mind is that, oh yeah, well, part of what's going on here is that as we become born again, then we have a place on the heavenly council, in that, you know, we have our brother that can advocate for whatever, you know, we pray for during the time of intercession, during the daily times of prayer. So, you know, I'm just thinking, okay, you know, as more of us are spending, you know, that hour interceding in particular, you know, so that all people on this earth, you know, are able to make a decision, you know, that at least they can hear the truth, and then they can make a decision and be judged, that, you know, that's fine. And so, you know, I'm just thinking, wow, that's going to be a huge part of all of this, too. Does that make sense?
Yeah, and I think Norman was right. That must be, you must have been thinking of my comment in regard to what I was thinking before I read Hawkins' mm-hmm. statement about
yeah.
that message. Yeah, that was it.
Yeah, I could have just asked him to begin with because he's nodding. But anyway, I just was thinking about that and how powerful that really is.
Amen. Mm-hmm. Awesome. Yeah, so, I mean, if anyone else does have anything, feel free to mention it. But if
okay, Trent, I'll go ahead and say something.
Yay, awesome.
When Teresa mentioned the trees, I think in Isaiah 60 or 41, or maybe Carol brought up Isaiah 60, I was thinking about the vision of the new church that Ellen White had, in which once they came out of the woods, they saw the little company, or they saw a company with, you know, brilliant crowns, robe, white, and then little ones following them, and they were on their way to Zion still. I know at some point, either before the temple or after the temple, she saw the trees, the box, the pine, the myrtle. And, I mean, it may be off topic, but it just kind of reminded me of that. So,
yes,
yeah,
me too.
Just thought I'd throw that out there.
Totally. No, that's definitely an important part of the vision, as every aspect, of course, is an important part. And at some point, when we get back to really doing that in-depth study on the seven thunders, I'm sure we'll go through that. I remember I wrote up a little thing, just more personal notes on the trees, comparing different passages of scripture that deal with those trees, and sent it to Doug when he was still around. And there's definitely a lot there with the trees. And it's definitely fitting that these passages would remind you and others of that.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah.
I'm pretty encouraged and amazed by all the interconnection. And that is, I mean, we have barely scratched the surface of all the interconnection.
Definitely. Really, throughout Scripture, it's incredible. And what comes to my mind as well, the more I study Scripture, the more I see how masterfully it was written. And that's both the case in the sense of the writing styles of those who wrote Scripture. They, you know, our Heavenly Family really chose people who had a thorough understanding of the messages that came before them, and could write things in such an incredible way using different styles of poetry and this and that, but also just the ideas that are there that our Heavenly Family gave to these people to write down in such wonderful ways, forming such a chain of truth. It's amazing. And it's written, you know, reading Isaiah here, it's like, wow, it's written in such a way where it has all these things which kind of, you know, you're reading one passage and it kind of foreshadows a little bit of what will be revealed more clearly in the next passage and harkens back to some of the other things that were previously expounded upon in other passages. And yeah, it's really incredible. It's a whole world of its own, so to speak. And yeah, I've been really, really happy to be studying a lot into this and studying in a thorough way. And I guess I'll start mentioning some of the things that I was looking into today in relation to all this. But still, even though I'm talking, that doesn't mean should interject. And actually, you know what? I just want to put it out there again if more people have things to say first.
I did think of one other connection, Trent.
Yeah?
When Teresa was reading about the trees, the cedars, acacias, and myrtles, olive trees, evergreens, firs, cypress growing together. Where I think Heavenly Family is saying that they will make cedars grow together in the desert. It reminded me of when I found the scripture, Nehemiah 8, verse 15, and that they should publish and proclaim in all their cities. That reminded me of Isaiah 40, you know, proclaiming, going up on a high mountain and heralding.
Right.
And in Jerusalem saying, go forth unto the mount, there's the mountain, and fetch olive branches and pine branches and myrtle branches and palm branches and branches of thick trees to make booths as it is written. So the people went forth.
Amen.
And there's the seventh month connection right here.
Yeah, you know, there's definitely some things in Isaiah 40 to 55 that have some sort of connection with Nehemiah. That's worth studying together as well.
There's a lot to study together. We got a lot to do.
Yes.
And since you put it out there, I do have one more thing that was really kind of cool to me that I want to share. Compare Isaiah 41:28 with Isaiah 59:16. Isaiah 41:28 says, "For I beheld, and there was no man, even among them, and there was no counselor, that when I asked of them, could answer a word." And Isaiah 59:16 says, "And he saw that there was no man, and wondered that there was no intercessor. Therefore his arm brought salvation unto him, and his righteousness it sustained him." So Isaiah 41:28 took me to Isaiah 59:16, which that in turn took me back to Isaiah 40, verse something. What was it, verse 11 and 12, maybe? 10 and 11, Isaiah 40, 10 and 11. Yeah, Isaiah 40, 10 and 11 is very closely connected to Isaiah 59, 16 and 17, where it's his arm. Well, here's what Isaiah 40, 10 says. "Behold, the Lord Yahweh will come with strength, and his arm shall rule for him. Behold, his reward is with him, and his word before him. He shall feed his flock like a shepherd. He shall gather the lambs with his arm, and carry them in his bosom, and shall gently lead those that are with young." And then Isaiah 59:16 and 17, I just read 16:17 says, "For he put on righteousness as a breastplate, and a helmet of salvation upon his head, and he put on garments of vengeance for clothing, and was clad with zeal as a cloak." So then that led me to Wisdom of Solomon. Because that's the language of the, you know, putting on the helmet and, you know, being clad with the gospel, basically, was the older, I guess the oldest reading of that is actually found in Wisdom of Solomon, right? Yes.
Could very well be.
Anyway, yeah, lots going on in these passages.
And I just wanted to mention in connection with that, Isaiah 59:16, the idea of no man and no intercessor. There's a lot more in Scripture that says that same sort of thing, and it's always in the same sort of context. And that knowledge of a time in which our Heavenly Family is seeking and there's no man, no one that they can use as an intercessor, that is an important idea to understand. And I think in a study that we had on Psalm 5, we got into that. And because Psalm 5 shows the end of that day.
Mm-hmm.
So it's an important idea. It definitely connects with the idea of dry bones and the sort of condition that you see in Micah chapter 7.
And there is a study on YouTube on Psalm 5.
Yes, there is. Excellent. All right. Anything else?
I'm done.
Okay, Teresa's done. Anyone else? I
just have one other quick thing.
No, I'm really enjoying this. This is what it should be.
Well, Sister White said in Ellen White manuscript that, you know, she saw verse 9 through 12 of, or 9 through 11 in particular, you know, referring to Christ. And so, but I think this is really interesting. She says, Isaiah saw Christ's triumphal entry into Jerusalem amid the praises and rejoicing of the people. And, of course, you know, it's a double application, I would think. And amid the praises and rejoicing of the people. His prophetic words are eloquent in their simplicity. And then she says, inspiration is revealed in this record of Christ's work. These closing chapters of the book of Isaiah should be diligently studied, for they are full of the gospel of Christ. Isn't that cool?
Amen.
And then she also says that, referring to verses 12 through 27, she said, you know, what she's talking about is when the questions start getting asked. Who hath measured the waters in the hollow of his hand and meted out the heaven with a span, you know, and all of that stuff. Who has directed the Spirit of the Lord, and on and on. Anyway, she says, these questions are directed to us as truly as they were to the Israelites. Can we answer them? And that's quoting her in Ellen White manuscript as well.
Mm.
I just thought that was kind of cool, just kind of little extra validation.
Amen. Yeah, really, really incredible. It's interesting. The triumphal entry of Christ came to my mind as well. Because it shows that idea of triumphal entry, but it's also just so humble. You know, the way that Yahweh here is portrayed in verse 11, 10 and 11 of Isaiah 40, it's just, you know, usually people think, oh, the Old Testament God is so harsh and so this and that. And when people think of God in a really nice way, they typically think of Jesus. And here is just such a clear passage in the Old Testament that is showing that character that is the character of Christ.
Mm-hmm.
Beautiful.
Norman has a comment.
Sure.
Okay. I won't go into all of it, but I just wanted to say if anyone's really interested in trees, to go to the Four Carpenters study by Doug and read about the parable of the fig tree
right.
And all the trees. It is very, very interesting. I just read it today. So.
Awesome.
Beautiful. Amen. I want to second that recommendation.
Mm-hmm.
Which one was it, Roman?
It's in the Four Carpenters, and it starts on page 68, the parable of the fig tree.
Oh, it's in the Four Carpenters. Okay.
All right. Were there any more comments? Things people have been studying? Okay. Well, anyways, hey, you know, if anyone else has anything, feel free. But, yeah, today in studying, I've been diligently studying all day and did not get as far as I thought I would. But I know that I got as far as I needed to. Basically, from verses 12 to 17 kind of forms the next natural section. And that it had some things in it that were really a challenge, just even in terms of finding out what it says and in terms of translation and so on. There was different things that it's like, what? Is that really what it says? Or what's that about? And so I spent a lot of time asking our Heavenly Family on different things and searching through different things and pulling up high-resolution scans of the Dead Sea Scrolls and trying to remember more Hebrew. But it's, yeah, I'm very grateful that 12 to 17, I have a lot better understanding of it now than I did last night. And so we can actually talk about it. And maybe we'll just quickly recap some of the other stuff, but in a lot more nutshell of a version than we did last night. But basically, some of the main things that we see in verses 1 to 11, and again, just for anyone who might listen to a recording of this later who hasn't listened to last night's study, I especially recommend last night's study to get an understanding of verses 1 to 11 of Isaiah 40. But I'll quickly give a nutshell of it. The basic message is that the time has come in which the everlasting covenant, also known as the new covenant, is beginning to be established here in these last days. And there is a message to be given to the heart of Jerusalem, who, as we learned, is the same as the daughter of Jerusalem in Ezekiel 16, which, of course, in our studies in Ezekiel 16, we have found is none other than the branch movement. So there's a message to be given to the branch movement. And then we find there's kind of a chain of revelation as to how that message finally gets to them. And what we see is it goes from Elohim to there's this voice. And then there, that's in verse 3. Then there's another voice in verse 6. And that voice speaks to someone who in verse 6 is being called into ministry to bear a message. And they deal with that in verses 6 to 8. And in verse 9, the message is born to Zion. And the message is actually telling Zion, that she is one who is supposed to herald a message. And she is to lift up her voice, not to be afraid, and she is to say to the cities of Judah, behold your gods. Behold, the Lord Yahweh will come with strength. His arm rules for him. Behold, his reward is with him and his work before him. Like a shepherd does he pasture his flock. He gathers nursing lambs with his arm and carries them in his bosom. He leads the ewe lambs that give suck. And we kind of went through that and found what is that showing. And, you know, we found out who the cities of Judah are, and we found that, and just again, Judah is that part of the anti-typical Israel or modern Israel, which after the Great Division still had the spirit of prophecy in their midst. And in the studies in Ezekiel 16, and Ben Roden also goes through typology dealing with this, we found that Judah represents the Davidian Seventh-day Adventist movement. And the cities of Judah are these different groups of Davidian Seventh-day Adventists. And this message is proclaimed to them, behold your Elohim, your gods. And Yahweh is pointed out as being Lord, being one who is now ruling, and he rules with his arm, and his reward is with him, and his work before him. You know, the kingdom is being established, but there's still all the establishment of it to really come to fruition. And he's portrayed as this king on a triumphal procession back to Jerusalem. But within that, as this is moving forward, he's a shepherd guiding his sheep, gathering his lambs with his arm, and so on and so forth. So won't get into all the details of that. But where we left off is basically in the midst of the message, which Zion, or the heart of Jerusalem, is told to proclaim to the cities of Judah. And that's basically where we left off. And so far as we understand at the present time, the following verses are a continuation of that message, which is to be sounded to the cities of Judah. And so we're going to be looking at verses 12 to 17. And like I said, there were certain places that it's like, okay, what's the deal with this translation? And last night I referenced certain of the resources that I've been using to go through and study this passage. And as I was looking at those resources, I saw some things that read very differently than the King James Version or other versions. And so then it really drove me to study it out more. And some of you might remember, I don't know, this might have been a year ago or more now, but there was a time when Teresa and I had available to us basically hundreds and probably even thousands of scholarly articles published in different journals that we could download for free. And it was just this thing that was going on for 7 days. And so we took advantage of that and downloaded hundreds of articles. Usually, a scholarly article, you know, it's something that's very different than articles by denominational quote-unquote scholars, which is basically all surrounded with and dealing with apologetics, which is defending the particular positions of the denomination, and it's very theological. So these aren't theological journals. These are scholarly journals which deal with translation and history and all that sort of stuff. So we were like, oh wow, we can download all this, because usually even to buy one article, it's like $30 to buy just one article. But I had this opportunity to download a bunch of these for free. It was this special thing that was on. And so we got hundreds of these articles, and so I was looking through, seeing if there were things that dealt particularly with the translation of this passage, and came across some good resources along with some of the other resources I had, and was really surprised to see how certain aspects of the translation of these verses that most translations contain are really not that good. And that's, you know, as a general rule, most translations pretty much contain the same basic idea in every passage, for the most part. But sometimes there's things where it's a very different idea, and it conveys a very different thought. And this is one of those places where we have that. So I spent a lot of time praying and studying, confirming what the passage actually says, first of all. And again, like we referenced last night, before we discover what a passage really means, we have to know even just simply what it says first. And so certain things, you know, for instance, take, I forget where it is, I think it's in the book of Acts somewhere, but in the New Testament, there's a place that talks in the King James Version about Easter. And it's, you know, blah, 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 and Easter, blah, 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 blah. And it's like, you know, if you kind of have that and you think that's what it says, then what you think it means is going to be based off of what it says. But if that's not what it says, then it's going to have a different meaning. So the passage, I believe, is actually, Acts 12, verse 4, is the one in the King James Version. It says, intending after Easter to bring him forth to the people, so on and so forth. And that translation, if you think that's what it says, then you will have a different view of Easter and about what people were doing at the time. You'll be thinking they were keeping Easter. But what the verse actually says in every single Greek manuscript is Passover, or the Greek word for Passover. And so you have to find out what it actually says before you can know what it means. That's just kind of an example to illustrate the point. And it is also an example to illustrate how every translation is already an interpretation. That's just the way it is. Every translation is already an interpretation. And so we're going to have to deal, that's why we talked about before how, hey, you know, we need to be trying to understand what it actually says. So there's some things here in this passage. And first, what I'm going to do is just simply read the passage, Isaiah 40, verses 12 to 17. And you'll notice some things that will be different from what you've read in the translations that you've most likely read in the past. And some things are going to be the same or even exactly the same. So, Heavenly Family, again, I just want to ask that you help us to understand this better than ever before. So, verse 12. Who has measured the waters of the sea in the hollow of his hand, and estimated the skies with the span of his hand? And who holds the dust of the earth in a third part, and weighs mountains in a scale and hills in balances? Who has estimated the spirit of Yahweh and the man of his counsel, whom she taught, or whom she makes known? We'll deal with that more. With whom has he counseled, and to whom has he given understanding, and taught him in the way of judgment, and taught him knowledge, and shows him the path of insight? Behold, nations are like a drop from a bucket, and are regarded as dust on scales. Behold, the coastlands weigh as much as powder, and Lebanon is not enough for kindling. Its wild beasts are not enough for burnt offering. All the nations are as nothing before him, and they are regarded by him as nothingness and void, or as at an end and empty. So we'll deal with different of the translation aspects as we go through this. But first, I just want to mention some of the things about the structure of this passage. This is kind of like a hymn, but it's also like a challenging type thing. There's these questions that are meant to be a challenge. But it's building off of what happened before it. one of the things that takes place, unfortunately, with certain of the mistranslations in this passage is that it ends up generalizing what is being said to the point where you lose the connection between this particular passage with what preceded it and what follows it. But this, still, the generalization gets across with most of the aspects, the basic idea. But understanding specifically what it's referring to and how it fits within its context, as in what took place prior to this specific passage and what takes place following, is so, so very important, because it's not just an arbitrary hymn thrown into the midst of this. As we've learned, the first 11 verses of this chapter have a lot more specific meaning than we have previously understood. And the same is true for this part. Now, this is actually just the situation with all these passages as we've come to learn them. I think I've referenced before how, you know, lots of people read something like Isaiah, and it's just this beautiful language. And so you read it, and you think it's this beautiful language, and it kind of just goes in one ear and out the other, and you don't really realize what it is actually saying. And the revelations that came through Victor Hodduff definitely showed a lot more of how, hey, look, Isaiah actually has some specific things to say. And these passages are talking about something a lot more particular than people usually consider them to be referring to. And when you see it for what it is, it's like, okay, yeah, that's what it is. Look at Isaiah 66, the escaped ones, those who escape being sent to the nations and so on. To most Adventists, that's just a beautiful passage of Scripture that they don't know what it means. And the only way really around the truth of what it's saying is to say, well, it doesn't really have that specific of a meaning, or, you know, try to not deal with it in a specific way. Because once you address it in a specific way, then it means something specific. And if what it specifically means is contrary to someone's doctrine, then they won't want to deal with it. But here in this passage, we have that same sort of thing where there's a specific meaning, and I just want to point out some of the things that illustrate that. So first, this whole thing is written, this whole thing being Isaiah 40 and the chapters that follow. It is written in a very particular style, and understanding that style will help a lot to comprehend its meaning. There are certain things that happen over and over again. And one of the aspects I'm going to mention, we won't be able to get into in detail, at least at this point, but maybe one day we will. I mentioned last night how this passage is a drama, and it's actually set up in a bunch of different ways. There's basically a prologue. There are six acts to this drama, and there's an epilogue. And within each act in this section of Isaiah, there is different subsections and also subsections within those sections. And it typically goes in different groups of threes. There's, you know, three sections to each act, and then within each three sections, there's three subsections. And this thing is repeated over and over again. It's very structured, and then within those structured elements are even more structured things. Like, you have, within the subsections, you have different things that relate from one section to another, and different kind of repetitive things within each section as differentiated from another section. So you have one subsection, for instance, you'll have verse 12 and 13, and then verses 14 and 15, and then verses 16 and 17, something like that. You have these different sections. And the first section in Hebrew, it'll be repeating a certain sound a lot, like eem. And in listening to it in Hebrew, it's very repetitive and very easy to recognize that someone is using that particular sound on purpose so repetitively. And then the next one, there's another sound that is repeated, but it's a different one than the first. And the third one, it's another sound. You know, I'm mentioning a few of these things just to illustrate how it's very structured and it's intentional the way things are written. And there's different things that interact with different things. So, for instance, in verse 12 and 13, you have these questions that are asked. And there are two times, one at the beginning of each verse, that is asking who. Who has measured blah, 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 blah. Who has estimated so on and so forth. And then in verse 15, you have, behold, nations, blah, 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 blah. Behold, the coastlands, blah, 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 blah. So you have these who's, who so-and-so, and then behold so-and-so. And actually, one corresponds to the other. In verse 12, who has measured the waters of the sea? That's the first who. The first behold is, behold, the nations are like a drop from a bucket, both dealing with this whole water thing. And actually, I'll mention some more of this. The next part in verse 12 is, and estimated the skies with the span of his hands. That has a parallel too. It's actually in verse 13. This one is the one that is kind of out of the order of what you would expect. And that's for a particular reason, and we'll get to that in a second. The next part of verse 12 is, and who holds the dust of the earth with a third part. In verse 15, the next part is, and regarded as dust on the scales. That being the nations are regarded as dust on the scales. Next part of verse 12, and weighs mountains in a scale and hills in balances. Again, in verse 15, talking about dust on scales, behold, the coastlands weigh as much as powder. And then it even continues on with the parallel with Lebanon is not enough for kindling, and its wild beasts are not enough for burnt offering, because Lebanon is actually a coastland and a mountainous range. That's paralleling the first part of verse 12. The last part of verse 12. So you see, verse 12, going into verse 15, it has all these aspects. It's the who is met with the behold, and one is answering the other. This is just to show the purposeful structure. Different parts are paralleling the other. But there's one part that's out of order. That's the second part of verse 12 that says, and estimated the skies with the span of his hand. That's paralleled by who estimated the spirit of Yahweh. Those are the same word in Hebrew. And it's paralleled for a reason, and there's another aspect too that we'll get to. But often in Scripture, you'll have things that are, you'll have a pattern, and then something breaks the pattern. And it does it to grab your attention. Think about Matthew 20 and the different calls. You have morning, third hour, sixth hour, ninth hour, and 12th hour? No, you don't have 12th hour, right? But why not? Isn't that the pattern? Going, you have morning, third, sixth, ninth. You're going in threes. You'd think that the next one would be the 12th, right? But it's not. It's the 11th. It breaks the pattern. And it's to focus you in on the 11th hour laborers and the 11th hour call, because that's the most important. So there's other examples that could be given too, but there's things that break the pattern, and that's what happens here. So in this passage, most translations read in a way, again, that kind of generalize it. Who has measured the waters of the sea in the hollow of his hand? And let me ask you guys, I'll just ask you that as a question, and you guys tell me the answer. Who has measured the waters of the sea in the hollow of his hand?
Yahweh,
okay. That's one answer that definitely could be given. Is there any other that could be given? There's a few answers that could be given. Someone might say that it's a rhetorical question that is supposed to get someone to say, no one. No one's done that. No one has been able to do that. And someone might say, Yahweh has done that. And, or you might say, no one but Yahweh, you know. And going on, you know, and estimated the skies with the span of his hand. Who's that talking about? In Isaiah's day, people would have had different answers. Actually, later in Isaiah, chapter 46, he talks about the god Bel. Bel was actually not a proper name for God. Bel was actually the name of, it's a title. It's Babylonian for Lord or Master, that sort of thing. And it's actually, most of the time when Babylonians said Bel, they were talking about the god Marduk. So Marduk is the one being referred to, that's his proper name in Isaiah 46. But in the writings of the Babylonians that gave praise to Marduk, they said, you know, something like, all praise to Marduk, who measures the waters of the sea, cultivates the fields, and so on and so forth. And here, Isaiah is dealing with a time when Babylon would be broken down. This is what's spoken of in chapter 47 and 46 and so on. And he actually speaks of Marduk. And so here there's this thing of, okay, well, who is it? People in his day, the Babylonians, would have probably said Bel or Marduk. Obviously, though, an Israelite would say Yahweh. And someone else might just read it and say, well, no one. And those, you know, saying no one and saying Yahweh aren't necessarily, you know, mutually exclusive or anything. But it's to kind of broaden the understanding of, okay, what is going on here? What is the thought? And the other thing I wanted to mention, some people in your translations, you might say, who has measured the waters in the hollow of his hand? It's from the Dead Sea Scrolls that it says, waters of the sea. And that seems to be the more original reading because of the context anciently with Marduk and how when they praised Marduk, they said the waters of the sea in the hollow of his hand. The reason why I just want to mention that is because there's another different reading later on from the Dead Sea Scrolls, and that just helps to substantiate that the Dead Sea Scrolls are giving the original reading. So we have this thing, okay, who has measured the waters of the sea in the hollow of his hand? What does that mean? Well, according to verse 15, that's talking about the nations, right? Measuring the nations, because the nations are like a drop from a bucket. They're the ones that are likened unto water. And we're familiar already with the idea of people and water, right? And estimated the skies with the span of his hand, we'll get back to that point. And who holds the dust of the earth in a third part. Some translations say something like, in a measure. The actual word there, it just means a third or three. And this is one of the ones that took me a long time looking of different things, and okay, well, what's the deal with that? What's this whole thing with the third part? How does that even make sense? And it's just seriously a difficult reading. Like, it's difficult to really get a glimpse as to what it's saying to some extent. However, yes?
Well, in that verse 15 in the King James, it doesn't even say third part. So if you were just reading out of the King James, would you not get the understanding?
No, it's verse 12 is actually what I'm referring to.
I don't think verse 12 mentions the third either.
Yeah, it doesn't say third part. It says, and who holds, this is in verse 12, though, in what it actually says is, and who holds the dust of the earth in a third part?
Mine says in a measure. And I'd noticed that before when you read it. I was just wondering, you know, does that limit us to understand if all we had was the King James? Is that third part? That's got to have meaning, doesn't it?
Right, well, that's the thing. The reason why they put the term measure is because they didn't know what third part meant. They just thought, well, maybe it's just the third part of some other greater measurement, like an omer or something, but it doesn't say omer. So they just put, it's some measure, it's a measure of something, it's a third part of something, so we'll just put measure. But if you just have the King James, you won't get what it actually says, because what it actually says is third part. And so that's, you know, one of those things that it's like, okay, well, what is that about? And we know from Victor Hodis' writings that the idea of a third part has significance. Not even just the third part of something, but the idea of a third in and of itself. Does anyone remember what that means? Teresa said wicked. Or is anyone else remembering that?
Would you say it again? Say your question again.
What does a third part mean?
Well, I remember a study in which you said, you know, that a third part would be saved, a third part would be lost, and it's Ezekiel. Is that quoting Ezekiel 16? Norman said. I vaguely remember the study in which he basically divided up all. You know, all the people groups according to their fate, you know, into thirds.
Yeah, there's actually two different passages that come to mind. Teresa mentioned Ezekiel 5, where you have the third part of hair, and then another third part of hair, and so on. The passage that came to my mind is actually in Zechariah 13 that talks about, and a third part this, and a third part that, and I will refine a third part, or purify a third part, as silver is purified. Both passages have that idea. Is there any other places that come to mind where it talks frequently about third part?
Wasn't it a third part of the angels?
Yeah, third part of the angels, Revelation 12.
Fallen.
Okay, now, is there another one that might come to mind that Davidians might be familiar with? A place that uses the idea of the third quite a bit. Okay, Teresa's saying something about the flood. Does that ring anyone's memory bells?
Yeah, it refers to like a third part of men or something like that, doesn't it?
Yeah, this is in the seven trumpets. It talks about the third part. And destructions coming upon various third parts in different contexts throughout the seven trumpets. And so Victor Hodis talks about this and goes through to show that a third part simply represents the wicked. And so this is an idea that, you know, is good to be aware of. And, of course, there are times in Scripture when it's specifically talking about a third part of something where it's not referring to the wicked. But when you just have a third, that's just a third on its own, you know, that's what's going on in the seven trumpets, for instance. And that's the idea that we have here. we have the idea of the dust of the earth in a third part, or just simply in a third. And later in verse 15, when it's providing further insight into the idea of the dust of the earth, it's again equating it with the nations, and it says they are regarded as dust on scales, or weighing as dust. The next part says, behold, the coastlands weigh as much as powder. And then it continues on talking about, and weighs mountains in a scale, and hills in balances. Now, the overall picture here is that there's some sort of judgment happening, right? Measuring. Revelation chapter 11 talks about measuring as being like judgment. Estimating something is also that same idea, or can be that same idea as measuring. Something being counted as a third part, or held as a third part, or in a third part. Something being wicked is a pronouncement of its condition. Weighing mountains in a scale and hills in balances, that's some sort of judgment, right? And that's not even just a small-scale judgment, even just the imagery of it. Weighing mountains in scales and hills in balances, that's talking about a big judgment taking place, right? And this is the type of judgment that isn't just the anger and wrath of God falling upon people. This is the sort of thing that things are being considered and measured, investigated, judged. That's the basic idea that's happening here. Now, something else that I wanted to mention about verse 12 is, and estimated the skies with the span of his hand. Okay, so who has measured the waters of the sea in the hollow of his hand and estimated the skies with the span of his hand? You know, I know that I haven't measured the skies with the span of my hand, and even the idea of it is purposefully to show how insignificant mankind is in comparison to these things. How can we compare, even just in terms of size, you know, the span of my hand compared to the sky? It is, the sky is infinite in comparison. But there's something more here. You know, every other aspect of this so far has further explanation after verse 12. But this whole thing of estimating the skies with the span of sand, what's that about? And basically, verse 13 is what begins to explain that. By using the same word that's translated here as estimate, in some things it might say measured, but a lot of translations translate this same word differently in verses 12 and 13. One might say marked out the skies or measured the skies. And when it says who has estimated the Spirit of Yahweh or the Lord's Spirit, it might say something really different, like who has discerned or something like that. But it's the same word in both instances. And the best word that I know of, at least, that captures the actual meaning of the word and that is applicable in both circumstances is estimated. Who has estimated the skies with the span of his hand? Who has estimated the Spirit of Yahweh and the man of his counsel? So on and so forth. Now, this thing here is like, okay, well, what's the connection between one thought and the other? Because remember, the idea of who has measured the waters of the sea, and behold, nations are like a drop from a bucket, that has a connection. It's the idea of water, and one is explaining more the other. The idea of dust is being explained in both passages. One has a connection with the other. So what's the connection with estimating the skies and estimating the spirit? Well, there's in a later in Isaiah, it expounds on the general idea of this more and on the specific idea of this more. In Isaiah 47, verse 13, it talks about people estimating the skies. And there it also uses another term, which is yada in Hebrew, which is to know and perceive. And it's the only other place within this whole context of Isaiah that uses that term other than Isaiah 40, verses 12 and 13. And it's talking there, let me just go to the passage, Isaiah 47:13. Basically, in its ancient context, it's talking about astrology. So, in this passage, it says, this is again, chapter 47 of Isaiah, verse 13. You are tired out from listening to take their stand, the ones who see omens in the sky, who gaze at the stars, who make monthly predictions. Let them rescue you from the disaster that is about to overtake you. So this is kind of an astrological type of issue that's happening here. And the thing is, they were using the sky to make predictions, to prophesy according to the stars, which, as we have seen, the stars represent the wicked gods. This is also in the Ezekiel 4 in context video that we have on YouTube. And in its pagan context in particular, they view the stars as these wicked gods, or at minimum as representing these gods. And they would divine the sky, and they would prophesy the future based off of that. So here in Isaiah 40, what is happening is that that whole idea is being paralleled with estimating the spirit of Yahweh. So who estimates the sky? In its immediate context, it's talking about the idea of simply who can measure the sky, who can say how large the sky is, and so on and so forth. But in its overall context, and in its poetic context, from verses 12 to 13, it's talking about something more than that. And what it's talking about in terms of its overall context of the passage, extending from Isaiah 40 and beyond, is countering what these false prophets were doing. And that's what's countered here. Who has estimated the spirit of Yahweh and the man of his counsel, whom she taught? The idea there is that just like none of the other gods and none of their other false prophets and so on can measure the waters of the sea in the hollow of their hand, and just like no one else can do that, and just like no one else can weigh the mountains and hills and scales and balances, just so no one can estimate the sky, no one else can estimate the spirit of Yahweh. So it's the idea that shows up later in Isaiah 41, where at the end, Yahweh challenges the wicked gods and the false prophets to show the future. That's what they're trying to do when they are estimating the sky. They're trying to show the future. So he's challenging, go ahead, show the future, and show us that you have shown the future. Show us what you've shown us from the past, and that it's actually come to pass. So that's what is being challenged here, that thought. Who has done this? No one but Yahweh. That's the answer. And that's the answer to a lot of questions throughout the rest of Isaiah, especially in chapters 40 to 55. Who has done this? Who has created this? Who has this and that? Yahweh, and only Yahweh. None of the other gods even compare. That's the idea. And that's, you know, a lot of these passages, by the way, these passages in Isaiah that talk about only Yahweh are the passages which seemingly are more definite or strong than any other passages in the Bible which people take to promote monotheism. But as we are seeing, the whole idea here is that no one else but Yahweh, none of the other gods are capable of doing what Yahweh is capable of doing. And all the other gods must bow down to Yahweh. These things are even said within these passages, indicating, of course, that these other gods exist. Also here, we have more than one Yahweh. Like we talked about before, we have these voices, and we have Elohim in verse 1, what we've already gone through, the first 11 verses of chapter 40. And here we have again mentioning the Spirit of Yahweh, and the Spirit of Yahweh here is one who teaches, clearly personified. So this is one other thing that I wanted to mention as far as translation. King James and a lot of the other translations read very differently than what verse 13 actually says here. So I'm going to read verse 13 again. Who has estimated the Spirit of Yahweh and the man of his counsel, whom she taught? The other possible translation of that is whom she makes known, but whom she taught seems to be the more natural reading. But it's one place here is where is this one difference in the Dead Sea Scrolls. At the end, when it's she, that's from the Dead Sea Scrolls. In the Masoretic text, it's masculine, and it's he, and the he is referring to Yahweh. Here, the she is referring to the Spirit. So one of the things that I was coming across with this passage, let me actually see if I can find the way it actually reads in the Masoretic text. You know, some passages or some translations read something like, who has directed the Spirit of Yahweh? The way that the Masoretic textual pointing makes it read is, who has directed the Spirit? Answer, Yahweh. And that's obviously a manipulation of the text itself. It really makes it disjointed, and it disconnects the first part of verse 13 from the second part, and so on. And the reason why the Masoretes had to point in a way so that it reads like that is because the idea of Yahweh having someone, you know, who directs the Spirit of Yahweh, having someone direct him just seemed absolutely unfathomable, or seemed very much just contrary to their theology. So they pointed in a way that is trying to say that who directs the Spirit? Well, Yahweh directs the Spirit. That sort of idea. In the King James, it reads something like, who hath directed the Spirit of Yahweh, or being his counselor hath taught him? And that way, it's reading it in a way that's like, it's a question that the obvious answer is supposed to be no. It's a rhetorical question, and it's like a challenging argumentative question. But there's major issues with that being the correct translation, both just in terms of grammar and in terms of the context of Isaiah. Because even later in Isaiah 46 verse 11, it actually talks about Yahweh having a counselor. And many things throughout all these passages in Isaiah talk about Yahweh's counsel, the counsel of Yahweh. We've talked about this before, the counsel of the gods, Psalm 82, and all these other things. And what I found out today is that there's actually whole books that scholars have written talking about the heavenly counselor and counselors in these passages in Isaiah, which I was surprised to find. One guy even wrote a book called The Heavenly Counselor in Isaiah 40, verses 13 and 14. It's like, well, okay, this guy wrote a whole book on the subject, a little odd. But anyways, the point being is that when it is translated according to how the Masoretes pointed it, or according to how the King James and other of the early English translations translated it, which translation, by the way, has been repeated often. It's been a traditional translation that people have followed. But when it's translated in that way, verses 13 and 14 seem to convey an okay thought in some regards, but it loses its connection with the rest of the context, what preceded it and what comes after it. So far, for instance, like we've talked about, verse 12 and 13 and all the way to 17 is supposed to be still part of the message that the heart of Jerusalem is, and, you know, Zion, is supposed to herald to the cities of Judah. And so far, let's see if this idea makes sense. Okay, what they say is, behold your gods. They say Yahweh is reigning. He is now returned as Lord, or he is coming with strength as Lord, as King, to rule. His reward or his kingdom is with him and his work before him. And he's like a shepherd. So you have this idea that seems almost, if not self-conflicted, surprising. You wouldn't expect this God who's coming like a warrior to be tending sheep and carrying little baby lambs and moving slow with his pasture. You wouldn't expect that with this dramatic warrior king coming and having this covenant renewed and all of this. So that raises some natural questions. Well, who has done this? You know, are the other nations going to be able to defeat Yahweh? How is this king and how is this movement going to succeed? If this is how the movement is going forward, how is it going to get anywhere? And so you have these questions dealing with these other nations. And, you know, the nations are like, wow, the other gods are like as vast as the sky, and the other nations are like the waters of the sea. But the answer is that, well, yeah, but to Yahweh, the nations are like a drop in a bucket, and they're as dust on the scales. So it's saying, hey, look, yes, Yahweh is coming forward in his kingship like a shepherd. And it's very humble. And this movement is going slow. And with that, it might look like there's never going to be any real progress or any real victory. And it looks like false religion, the other gods, the nations are just ruling the day, and it's going to stay like that for forever. But the message here is, no, Yahweh is the one who is judging the nations. And Yahweh is judging the wicked gods. And Yahweh is judging the churches and the sects. And Yahweh is the one who can tell the future. Yahweh is the one who is appointing knowledge to be manifested in the earth. Therefore, Yahweh will have the victory. That's the message that this is conveying. That's what we find in verse 13 and 14 when we understand it correctly. Who has estimated the spirit of Yahweh and the man of his counsel? So here, it's actually in Hebrew, the man of his counsel. The word for man is ish. I forget the pronunciation of the Hebrew word for counsel, but that's what it says in the text. Who has estimated the spirit of Yahweh and the man of his counsel? His counsel, the his is referring to Yahweh, is the man of Yahweh's counsel, whom she being the spirit, taught. With whom has he counseled? And to whom has he given understanding and taught him in the way of judgment and taught him knowledge and shows him the path of insight? So what we have here is not a bunch of questions saying who has taught Yahweh, who has counseled and advised Yahweh, who has given Yahweh understanding and taught him judgment and taught him knowledge and showed him the path of insight. It's actually asking, with whom has Yahweh counseled and to whom has Yahweh given understanding and taught the way of judgment and taught knowledge and shown the path of insight, or shows the path of insight? This actually has connection to what came before and what follows. Because what came before? We have someone called to bear a message to Zion, to the heart of Jerusalem. And in the message that Zion bears to the cities of Judah, they talk about this aspect of kingship, they talk about this shepherding, and they talk about this aspect of Yahweh ruling with his arm and gathering his lambs with his arm, ruling as king. And, you know, looking at passages like Ezekiel chapter 34 and Jeremiah 30 and 31 and a number of other passages, we know that this is talking about the time of the reestablishment of the tabernacle of David. And this is talking about a time when our heavenly family has appointed an arm through which they deliver a message and gather their sheep. And this is what's happening in verses 13 and 14. And this finds its parallels. Again, we just made the connections with what is before. But actually, every one of these aspects, Yahweh having counseling with someone, Yahweh giving someone understanding, teaching someone the way of judgment, teaching someone knowledge and showing him the path of insight. Every one of those aspects, those phrases, actually show up later in Isaiah from 41, chapter 41 to 55, in reference to Cyrus and David. And that isn't just by chance. Like, in, I'll just go to a couple of, I'll read a couple of the references here. In Isaiah 46:11, and this again, I'm going to be reading it from the King James, or no, sorry, not the King James, the NET. And so it won't be phrasing it in the same way, but it's the same phrase in Hebrew where it talks about the way of judgment, giving him knowledge in terms of the way of judgment. And actually, that's in the next passage I'll read. This one is the counsel, the man of counsel, and with whom has he counseled? That phrase shows up in chapter 46, verse 11. But here it says, referring to Yahweh, who summons an eagle from the east, from a distant land, one who carries out my plan. Yes, I have decreed, and it will come to pass. I have formulated a plan. Yes, I will carry it out. The way it reads, let me see if, could you go there in the King James, chapter 46, verse 11?
I have it whenever you need
it. Okay, you can read it.
Calling a ravenous bird from the east, the man that executeth my counsel from a far country, yea, I have spoken it. I will also bring it to pass. I have purposed it. I will also do it.
Thank you. Yeah, so the thing there of man who executeth my counsel, in Hebrew it's actually just simply the man of my counsel. Same thing as in chapter 40. In chapter 42, verses 1, 3, and 4, it talks about judgment being appointed. And actually, I'll just read some of that. Chapter 42 of Isaiah, verses 1, 3, and 4. Behold, my servant, whom I uphold, mine elect, in whom I delight. I have put my spirit upon him, and he shall bring forth judgment to the Gentiles. A bruised reed shall not break. Again, that's skipping ahead to verse 3. And the smoking flax shall he not quench. He shall bring forth judgment unto truth. And so on and so forth. That's the way it's going through it in chapter 42. And in chapter 50, verse 4, it talks about being taught knowledge using the same phrase as is there in chapter 40. So in all these passages, it's that same thing. And let's see, continuing on, or I'll mention the last part, is, and shows him the path of insight. Some other translations there might say the path of understanding or insight. It's you could translate it in different ways. Insight is definitely a clear way to describe it. But what this is showing is that here in the first chapter of this section of Isaiah, chapter 40, it is introducing all these different elements which show up later in chapter 41, 42, 43, all the way through. And recognizing these different elements is very much important and even necessary in order to gain the most out of what the chapter and the whole context is actually saying. So we'll see when we get to chapter 41, especially at the end, this part will come again when our Heavenly Family brings the challenge and says, hey, look, who can declare what is going to take place? Who can do this? And he says, there is none. And then repeats the same thing of, I've appointed one, so on and so forth, and uses some of the same language that we find here. This is all part of that message that the daughter of Jerusalem, or Zion, or the heart of Jerusalem, is to proclaim to the cities of Judah. And the reason why it's proclaimed to the cities of Judah is because the cities of Judah should know these things. And to bring it into real modern terms, the Davidian movement should really know about the reestablishment of the House of David. This is something that they really should know. After all, they're called Davidians. The reestablishment of the Davidic kingdom is the message of the Davidians. And passages like this are explaining that to us. Passages like this are showing us how the reestablishment of the Davidic kingdom takes place. And most Davidians are, unfortunately, expecting that kingdom to come about in the same way that Jews were expecting the kingdom to come about. And again, the Jews were simply the Judah of their day. But Davidians are expecting the kingdom to come about in the same way that Jews were back then. Lots of times Davidians think, oh, well, in the days of Christ, it was the time for the kingdom of grace. But here in the last days is the time of, for the kingdom of glory. Back then they were expecting the overthrow of the Romans, but they were just wrong on the time. But today, that's when it's going to happen. The nations are going to go down, and it's going to be really clear to everyone, and they have this picture that that is what it's going to be like. That what the Jews expected in that day was wrong only in terms of the time in which it was referring to, but that it will happen like that today. What passages like this tell us is that, no, that's not how the kingdom is established. In fact, the reason why Christ went about the establishment of the kingdom the way he did is not as simply it wasn't time to come and show everyone who's boss. It's because that's not how Christ operates. Mm. That's not the character of our heavenly family. Mm-hmm. Back then, the kingdom of God was at hand, just as truly as it is today. And back then, the everlasting covenant began to be fulfilled, just as truly as it is today. Back then, the reason why it did not happen in terms of the reestablishment of the kingdom in power is because people fell away from righteousness. If the same thing happens today, then the same thing will happen. But just as it didn't have to happen back then, it doesn't have to happen today. What we're told is that, hey, our Heavenly Father is a shepherd, and he takes care of his sheep, and he is bringing about his kingdom, and he does it by grace, unto glory. It's righteousness springing forth in the earth. So our Heavenly Family, this is the message to Davidians. Look, don't expect all of a sudden to have, boom, slaughter takes place, and then you go to the land of Israel, and there's this king there who's the antitypical David, who you never heard of before, and he just suddenly shows up as a king, ready to rule and judge the nations. Is that the character of our Heavenly Family? I thought David was just the shepherd boy, and he didn't just all of a sudden show up as some dominating king. David was there just playing his harp, singing a song, trying to soothe Saul. You know? It's really in ignorance of Scripture that people think the kingdom will be established in the way that they do. Our Heavenly Family comes to us having a song for us to hear, speaking comfortably and kindly to us, wanting to tend to us as their sheep, lead us forth as an exodus, men, women, children, cattle, moving forward, not looking all that threatening, just looking like a bunch of captives that were liberated. And that's how they are setting up this kingdom. And that's what Davidians need to understand, that it has begun. The kingdom has begun to be established, and the house of David is being restored, and that it's as a mustard seed. It looks small and insignificant. But really, what is truly small and insignificant is the seemingly impossible task of gaining victory in that way. Mm. In the eyes of the world, setting up a kingdom the way our Heavenly Family is setting it up today seems an impossible task. Just as impossible, perhaps, as the disciples thought when they saw Christ and they knew he was the Christ, they knew he was the Messiah, and they wanted to have him at Jerusalem and have him demonstrate that he's king. And what did he do? He kept running away and going off to Galilee and talking to the humble folk, trying to help someone who is thirsty or hungry or sick or dying, to speak to a woman at a well, to give her words of life. And that's how Christ was setting up his kingdom and is setting up his kingdom. It's not the grace of the past and the glory of the future. It is by grace unto glory. And I think that's absolutely beautiful. So thank you, Heavenly Family. Mm-hmm. Does anyone have any thoughts or comments?
I just want to second that emotion. That is absolutely beautiful.
Amen.
Sir.
What was that? Oh, you said third?
Yeah.
Yeah.
I said that.
Amen. Yeah. Even though I guess I originally said it all fourth of that. It's,
that's right. It'll be fourth.
Yeah. But I personally think that our Heavenly Family is absolutely loving and beautiful in the way that they are doing this. And I think, and I not only think this, but the scriptures here declare that that's what Davidians need to hear. And it's really, all of that can be summed up in, behold your gods. Because it shows them who they are and it shows them their true character, how their kingdom works and how they establish it.
Just that, that's just what I was thinking. It's like, wow, this is such a pleasure and a privilege to get to know our Heavenly Family. And, you know, I was just thinking, yeah, okay, friend, let me introduce you to your Heavenly Family. Behold your God.
Yes. Amen.
As I was reading ahead, you know, in Isaiah there, I think it's up to like 55 or whatever, is what you suggested reading, or even further. But, yeah, I was marking several areas that really looked interesting. And I'm thinking, boy, I can't wait to find out what that means, you know. Sometimes you get a little idea, but it's really interesting the way it's written, several areas.
Yes, these chapters are full of light and full of present truth. And I had no clue at the beginning of this feast that this is where we would be focusing. And I'm glad that this is where we're focusing, though. Isaiah, the gospel prophet, right?
I get it why they call it the feast.
Amen. Amen. Totally. Beautiful.
I am so blown away at the realization of how, as Davidians, we have been looking and expecting for the setting up of the kingdom in all the wrong ways. And I feel like so just shamed that I've ever had the thought that, oh, okay, well, our Heavenly Family's character is other than what it actually is. That, okay, yeah, one day they're going to just be, like you say, showing everyone who's boss. And that just is not their character. It never was and it never will be. And will judgment have to be meted out? Yes, of course.
A strange act.
Yeah, that's why it's his strange act. But while there is any probation left for anyone, the same loving, merciful call to be a part of that heavenly kingdom will be sent out, just like it was when Christ walked the earth.
Amen. Well, shall we thank our heavenly family? Let's do that. Heavenly family, I want to thank you and praise you for the revelation of yourselves to us and what this night illustrates for me is that you are more and more making yourself manifest to us so that we can say to others, behold your gods. It is so evident from the knowledge that you are imparting to us that you are so desirous for everyone else to hear it. I know that you don't give it to us just to ourselves be taken back by it. But you're giving us a mission. And it's a mission which we gladly accept, Heavenly Family. Here I am, send me. Also recognizing our complete insufficiency and inability to discern your word and to teach you. You know, none of us can estimate your spirit, Yahweh. But we know that she has been sent to teach us all things. And for that, we thank you. Thank you so much for loving us. Thank you for having an unchanging character. Thank you for establishing your kingdom by grace and through faith and unto glory. Thank you, Father and Mother. In the name of your begotten Son and begotten Daughter, Branch.
Amen.
Amen. Well, as I said last night, I look forward to seeing what they're going to show us in the next 24 hours. And I look forward to seeing, you know, all discussing together again what we find as we go and study. The scriptures are full of truth and light and love and grace and righteousness. And, I just want to encourage everyone to keep diving in. I so thoroughly enjoyed the discussion that we had earlier, and I look forward to more of it tomorrow. And I just keep on wanting to say amen and l'chaim to life.
Yeah, what he said.
we'll have to practice our guttural.
Could you interpret that, please?
What is that?
I said, could you interpret that, please?
Oh, yes. L'chaim, to life, is what it means.
All right.
Yes.